2 Corinthians chapter 3. Do we begin again to commend ourselves? You know, do we lift ourselves up? Or need we, as some others, epistles of condemnation to you or letters of condemnation for you? We're going into the ministry now. We've been talking about the triumphal ministry, chapter 2, 14 through 17. Ye are our epistle written in our hearts. So what's the letters? Anybody can write letters. Anybody can say anything. And what Paul is saying, listen, you at Corinth, you Corinthians, what you're doing, your growth, what your church is prospering in, the doing that you're the written word. You're the written aspect. You're the proof. I don't need to write anything. You are working, showing your salvation to Jesus Christ. I don't have to write. There are people who write letters and write things. And, you know, what is the true work? Known and read of all men. So, our lives are a written testimony to God and to everybody saved or lost. They took one look at you and say, all right, he calls himself a Christian, and what's your words say by your actions, by your works? Now, not works to be saved, but works because you're saved. Are you living up to of who you are? In other words, if they were to drag you into a courtroom today, and the charge would be, you're a Christian, could you walk out of that courtroom as guilty? Or could you walk out of that courtroom saying, no, you're not a Christian? Your life, you wouldn't need your pastor of your church say, pastor, will you write a letter to the court and get a couple friends? Will you write a letter to the court saying, no, I am a Christian? No, you wouldn't need that kind of letter. Your life, your conduct, the witnesses, the people that you live with, the people that you work with, the people that are associated with you. You pull the people downtown from the farmer's market, they'll stand before and say, yeah, we hate them, but he preaches that Bible. And Paul is saying, you know, condemn ourselves. I mean, am I writing this letter for me? No. I'm not trying to lift myself up. I'm writing this letter for your sake. The first letter we've already seen by chapter 2, this guy got right. Hey, there's things going on now in the Corinth church for good. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us. You're the written letter. Your life. And it came by us. Again, epistle of Christ. Chapter 2, verse 12, Christ's gospel. Verse 14, the triumph in Christ. 15, the sweet Savior of Christ. 17, we speak in Christ. Now we've got the epistle of Christ. Everything, and you want to be a Christian? You got to have it of Christ. And when the media speaks about that big organization worldwide to call them Christian, they ain't nothing of the Bible. Matter of fact, they're against what the Bible says. Our conduct, our lives, is a written statement to all that we are in Christ by following what the Bible says. Written not with ink. Some people will keep a diary. There's nothing wrong with a diary. There's nothing wrong with a journal. But not every Christian keeps a journal or a diary with ink. And yet, we are right in our lives. Before God, saved and doing what we're supposed to be doing, or saved and being a couch potato. We're writing something down. Paul recorded about this Corinth church, man, you guys are carnal. You got all kinds of sin. You're striving for the wrong things. That's a bad epistle. Hey, this guy's got right. Welcome into the church. You're suffering. You're still honoring. Pray for me. Help me. This is a good epistle. Of what you're doing. But not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God. Ooh. There's the Holy Spirit, and there's God. Two members of the Trinity. There's Christ ministered by us. There is the Trinity in 3-3. In order to be the Christian, you've got to have the Trinity working together in your life to be a Christian. The living God. Not Satan. How can you have Satan working in your ministry? By doing worldly things in your ministry. But with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone. Okay, now we're going to go back to the law. We got to bring the law back. The law is always causing trouble. And you know, what were the tables of stone? The Ten Commandments that Moses brought down, which he broke. And had to go back and get them rewritten and brought down. So now we're going to have, now something in the Corinth church is crept in. The keeping of the law. And we got to deal with it again. And even 2017, I was going to say 16. 2017, there are churches probably within 15 miles, if not less, that they'll teach you that you need to do something as far as the law to be saved. You need to do something for salvation, something other than what the merit of Jesus Christ. That's a problem that comes to today. Remember we read in verse 17, chapter 2, there are Bible correctors. Well, as in 60 AD, thereabouts, in 2017, there are people that will tell you, you need to do something to be saved. I'm reading about the Bible and talking about Martin Luther. He would crawl up these stairs. He would do penances. He'd do all these things and make himself hurt. And he still, when he got to the top of the stairs, he didn't feel clean. He didn't feel right. So now these tables of stones, we're looking at the Ten Commandments. But in fleshy tables of the heart. So we got stones and we got our heart. Now we're back to a heart condition. In reference to God. And such trust have we through Christ to Godward. All right. For Jesus Christ, our trust to God. Now that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as ourselves, but of sufficiency is of God. Who also has made us able ministers of the New Testament. Talking about Paul. We are in the New Testament. That does away with the tables of stone. That was the Old Testament. When did the New Testament start? Well, in order to have a last will and testament, what has to happen to put that will and testament in order? It had to be the death of Jesus Christ. So, Paul again now, Old and New Testament. Not of letter. And you go back and read the law. It's there. Not most of your New Testament is written yet. But of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. For the letter killeth. All right, that law made you guilty. Thou shalt honor thy mother and father. Okay, that's a good commandment. And we all should do that. That thy days may be prolonged on the land. Or in the land, whatever else it said. So wait a minute. If I did not honor my father and mother. And it's repeated later, but let's go by what we know right now. I was to be taken to the city or the town, to the gates of the city. My parents would say that this child is wicked, will not listen to me. He's a glutton. He's a drunkard. And I'd be stoned because the law says I did not honor my parents and do right. That killed me. If I were to commit adultery, I would be charged before the city folk and they would be stoned. That law told me death. The wages of sin is death. There were two sins in the Old Testament that nothing could be bought, nothing could be done that you could redeem yourself. For the letter killeth, comma. comma, but the Spirit giveth life. Okay, for the wages of sin is death. That law tells me I'm a sinner and I'm going to die. But the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Now I got hope. I've got the precious blood of God, which cleanses me from all sin, to give me eternal life, signed, sealed, and never to lose it. These things I have written unto you, that you may know you have salvation. The law couldn't do that. Tell me, King Saul, is he saved in heaven? He went to a witch. Well, that's not one of those damnable, you're going to hell quickly things. I mean, it wasn't murder. He didn't kill David. It wasn't adultery. And yet, there's a remark in the Old Testament, and I forget who said it was. It kind of mentions that Saul will maybe could see David. Now, I don't know if that's between a gulf or whatever it is. But that law, if you did everything you were supposed to, all right, you went to Abraham's bosom. You didn't get the land grant. You remained in Abraham's bosom until Jesus died and was buried and rose again. And then he set the captives free out of Abraham's bosom. You could have done your right your whole entire life and then mess up at your death and go into hell. As a Christian, no. I could get saved and I could sin, I could fall out of the will of God, but I can't lose my salvation. But we're talking about law and we're talking about grace. We're talking about the New Testament, we're talking about the Old Testament. But if the ministration of death, written and engraved in stones, was glorious. It was glorious. It told me, those Ten Commandments told me who I am. I'm not right with God, and I'm not right with my neighbor. That's what it told you. You can't get by the First Commandment. Because the First Commandment is God first all the time, and as a born-again, Bible-believing Christian, who God's given me the ability to teach His Word, I don't even get by the First Commandment. Never mind the rest of nine. I don't mess with the other nine. I can't get the first one done. You know, if I'm saved and could lose it and then have the rapture happen and miss the rapture because I lost it, end up in the tribulation, I'm going to go to hell. What, you're not going to try to do it? Wait a minute. The tribulation is based upon works. One of those works is God first all the time. I can't do that. Was glorious. That law, even though we're not under law, it was great. It showed me something. So that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away. And remember when Moses came down from that mountain, his face shone. Because what? He's seen God. He's seen God's glory. They're vile, wicked sinners. Like, oh. Now listen, if Moses' face gloried by seeing God, and they couldn't bear to look upon his face, do you think that these Israelites could look upon God in his holiness? Absolutely not.
Yeah, Moses was a sinner too.
Yes. But he's seen that glory of God and reflected in his face. And God said, I had to put you in a cleft of a rock, and I have to hide your eyes, and you can see my backside. I won't tell you what other Bibles say about that one. It's almost sickening to think about. But that glory that Moses got, even Israel couldn't even look upon his face. For the glory of God, the peak that Moses got to see. And Moses was a sinner. And what part of God that really couldn't see? He couldn't see all God, but he got the glory upon his face. And the law he couldn't say, okay, here's a law, okay, bring this, and we all can look upon me, and we all can look, we can go up to that mountain. He starts up that mountain with Joshua, so Joshua, stop, you got to stay here, you can't go any further. Where do we find anything wrong with Joshua recorded? You stay here, Joshua. I got to go up further.
Well, like David, he was a man of war.
Well, he's a man of war. And it's kind of funny because in that dispensation of Jesus Christ living, breathing on this earth, that was a weird dispensation. But there are three men that are asleep. And Peter's rubbing his eyes, wakes up. Oh, Moses and Elijah and Jesus in his glorified state as Moses' face was. So was Jesus. No fuller on earth could make him any clearer. And there's those three men looking at them and under Jesus Christ. They could stare and not have their eyeballs poked up and not burn up into ashes right there. You notice that? Peter got time to say, hey, let's make a tabernacle. In the law state, you can't even touch the foundation of that mountain, either with a goat, a ram, or even a person. A dart with it. Grace brings us closer to God where the law couldn't. Moses said, God, I want to see your glory. He says, I got to put you in that cleft. I got to cover your eyes. And we don't even know what even percentage he saw of God. And yet, whatever percentage he saw of God, his face glowed. Don't you think that day when, let's say for a minute, I believe in the rapture, I know it's going to happen, let's say it's going to be put off. Let's say you die. The Bible says, absent from the body, present with, aren't you think you're going to have that glow when there he is finally standing in front of you? And you're going to look, this is my thinking, you don't have to take it perfectly well, but I think you're not going to walk up to Jesus and say, hey, I'm mine, how you doing, what's up? I think you're going to be down on your knees and you're going to see some toenails. And I believe the next thing is you're going to see a feet that have holes. And as you pick, as he allows you to pick yourself up, you're going to be humbled before him. And then when you really get, your eyeballs just blow, and your family are there in the hospital room crying over you, and you just got tears, your face is just glowing because there he is. There is the blessed hope. Wouldn't that get you glowing? And your and the circuit box in your body ain't going to pop, the fuses ain't going to go, you're going to be, I'm here. Could they say that about David? And yet David's mentioned in the Hebrews chapter 11, the heroes of faith. Could you say that about Abraham? You know, he went to his own, he went to his bosom. Could you say that about the Lazarus, the one that knew Mary and Martha? No, you couldn't say that about him. Could you say it about the thief that died on the cross? No, not yet. He went to Abraham's bosom. So the law profess who we are, guilty before God. And so what would a church do to keep you guilty under God today? Well, if you give us money, we'll get you indulgences. We'll get you, pray for us and candles, and we'll get your husband out of purgatory. We'll get him less days. We use it for a profit. And I'm not talking about a guy who's going to tell you about the future. See, if you can hold somebody under the law, what did the Pharisees and the Sadducees do to the people in Jesus' time? And Jesus said, take my yoke. Get off their yoke. And their yoke won't even get you into heaven. They're hindering you to heaven. The law brings death. Christ and glory in the New Testament, and grace brings life. One sacrifice. Engraving with stones was glorious so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away. Done away how? He died. He died and they buried him. Moses died. He got angry. And he died. He did not get the promised land because he got angry. Isn't that interesting? He did not get to go in the promised land. But later on, he'll get the new earth. he'll go in. But he got a special exception like David. He got to go in the promised land much later with Elijah and Jesus Christ himself. So some of the things with the law, like David, you do get little special advantages. The law living. If you were rich, that would pretty much mean you were right with God. Yes, in the law. Not under mercy. Would you look at Paul and his life and the way he lived? Would you even think he was right with God? Anybody would think he is wrong with God. Man, the guy is beaten. The guy is prison. The guy ain't got nothing. The guy is forsaken. And he can't be doing right for God. And yet he's doing so much for God. When did David ever go out and witness for God? When did he ever tell people about God? Not one place. Where did David ever start synagogues or temples? He didn't even build a temple for the Jews to come and worship. So we're two different periods. How shall not this ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more does the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. So there's a ministration. There's glory. Glory to God in the highest. Condemnation. Righteousness. Condemnation is opposite of righteousness. It's what God says to do, how God prescribed the way of salvation. In the law, you bring a sacrifice. Today, under grace, you bring Jesus' blood, God's blood, Acts 20:28. Now, see, that's the difference. All right? When I come to God, I come to God with God's blood, Acts 20:28. If I were going to church in any one of the mother churches or Protestant churches, that wine is somehow either the blood of God or a symbolic blood of God, semi-transformant, magic tricks and all that, that ain't God. The blood I atone for my salvation was shed on Calvary. It's not shed in a little cup that you can pass around in a church building. How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, the law brought condemnation. Much more does the ministration of righteousness. Who is righteous? What is my righteousness? Jesus Christ. Exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. The law cannot outdo Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ fulfilled the entire law. The law never fulfilled Jesus Christ. So don't come to me telling me, bragging about what you can do for salvation. Can it merit to what Jesus done? It says in the Bible, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. It doesn't say for God so loved the world that he commanded you to do something. Because what Jesus done being sent by God fulfilled it all. One sacrifice. The Old Testament, they had to go three times every year. The Day of Atonement was every year. The Passover was every year. I had to come to Christ once for true salvation. Now, I come to him often because I'm an often sinner, but that's not to be resaved. That's just, you know, Lord, I've broken a fellowship between you and me. I've been disobedient to you, Father. I got to make it right. But that doesn't resave me. I'm still his son. He's still my father. But the law, you had to keep going back. For if that which is done already, done away, the law, was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. For if that which is done away is glorious, the law, much more that which remaineth, Jesus Christ, is glorious. Seeing that, remember, he fulfilled the entire law. The law was done through him. Seeing then that we have such hope, do you hope that you're bringing a lamb without spot? Do you hope that inside your goat, it doesn't have a stomach illness? Remember, they're supposed to check those animals out? Wasn't supposed to have a spot. Are you hoping that whatever you bring to the gate of that thing, you know, that animal could be sick and you may not know it? Now, how about the sinless, precious blood, the Lamb of God, which take away the sin of the world? How's that for a hope? We use great plainness of speech. Paul did not use the Greek. He did not use the, well, he probably used Hebrew speaking, I don't know. But he didn't use big, swelling words. He probably used words that any fifth or sixth grade child could understand. Now, I've talked about the Bema seat of Christ. No, judgment seat of Christ. Everyone understands judgment. Go on the street and preach, and eventually, sometime in your lifetime, you'll have somebody come up to you. Bema not seen, but, you know, Bema do you. No, they'll say, judge not, lest ye be judged. They know the correct words. And you use plainness of speech because you don't want it to go over their head. Remember what Proverbs said, and I'm not making fun of simple people, but there are simple people who don't know. There are people today who do not know who Jesus Christ is and would not have the foggiest idea who he is. So you're going to come out of college, use big college words on these people who don't know? How hard is the gospel? There is a man sent by God who is God. He was born of a virgin. That means the woman had never had any kind of sexual relations with no man. Prophesied by the Bible. He lived for 33 and a half years. The 3.5 years of his life, he ministered, went about fulfilling the law his entire life, healing people, went about removing devils. He went about proclaiming God and his word, proclaiming the kingdom to a people called a nation of Jews, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That nation, by scripture, rejected him. They had him turn over to the Roman government because they were not to stone him. By the scripture, that not a stone, not a bone of him be broken, that he would have to be lifted up, as according to the scripture, to die on a cross, that his sinless blood, God's blood, Acts 20:28, says that their sin, that blood was washed our sins away. They took him down off that cross. What big words am I using? They put him in a tomb. You know a tomb? You ever see one of those buildings in a graveyard? They put him in something like that. It was a cave. They rolled a stone on it. They had guards. They set a seal. And then 3 days later, Jesus Christ came out of that tomb alive and well and is seated at the right hand of God the Father today. What big words I use, and yet that's salvation right there. And that comes right out of a Bible. I can read it to the person. I wouldn't even know how to do big words for that. But I guarantee you, if I recall some Christians from, or probably wouldn't even guess they were Christians, from these cemeteries, big name cemeteries where they go to get transformed out of the Bible, get removed out of King James Bible, I bet you they could say what I just said to you with big, long, flowery words and get you all confused and mishmash. Plainness of speech. And not as Moses, the law, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished, the law. They couldn't look on Moses' face. That law that he brought down was abolished, was gone, done. No more. You can't tie to it no more. For salvation. I can show you by the law yours. I can open up to Acts 20 and say, listen, if you've done this, I can show you that. You're guilty before God. Well, what do I need to do? Now, I'm not going to take you to Leviticus and show you the offerings. No. I'm going to take you to the New Testament and show you the offering, God, Jesus Christ. So the Old Testament was abolished. It's done. What if Let's say overnight while we're sleeping, the President of the United States and Congress says, all paper money is dissolved. It's no longer good. We're no longer, as a government, while you're sleeping, no longer is paper money acceptable currency. And you get up in the morning and you go down to your coffee shop and you get your coffee and your donut or your bag or whatever, and you hand them a $5 bill and they say, no, I can't take it. Why? It's done. They abolished that last night while we're sleeping. Your money's no good. You can't get what you want. It's been abolished. No longer in use. You can't say, well, here's a 5, here's a 10. It's been abolished. It's done. It's worthless. You can't run to the law. It's been abolished. It's done. You can't run to those animals. It's done. How is it done? By Jesus Christ. And if God says that that's abolished, and this is my son, this is the gift, Jesus Christ, for eternal life, you're not coming to God. You'll be saying the great white throne, but then what did I do? Didn't I do rosaries? Didn't I sell magazines? Didn't I do it? I didn't believe in it. And say, that is abolished. It's done. It was my son. Religion is man-made. Jesus Christ is God-approved and will always be approved. And if you look at the law, all the law points you to somehow, some way, to Jesus Christ, God's Son. The Passover, all the feasts, the offerings. That lamb that they're offering the Passover, there was a week that they were to examine that lamb to make sure that lamb was perfect. And the last few weeks of Jesus, the Gospel of John records they examined him. And he was found innocent. He was found without fault before they sacrificed him. So the law is abolished for salvation. But I can read through the law and I can read some things in there that, uh-oh, that's what I've done. I'm guilty. I'm just as guilty as that Old Testament character that was guilty. I need to get right. I don't bring an animal. I bring the blood, 1 John 1:9. This is what he's teaching them. But their minds were blinded. For unto this day remaineth the same veil, untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament. Now, what's that? In 2007, there are synagogues all over the world. Their rabbi will get up to the podium, pulpit, whatever they call it, and he'll open up the Old Testament somewhere. And he'll read that Old Testament like a preacher would read a portion of Scripture to his congregation. And Paul is saying, when that rabbi reads the Old Testament, not, they have nothing to do with the New Testament. That veil that was upon Moses' face is on them. You go to a Jew who goes to temple service and ask him to explain Isaiah 53. You know what he'll tell you? That suffering servant is the nation of Israel, and the one that's causing the suffering is the Gentiles. I've heard it said. Not only have I been taught that, but I've heard it said to me. They don't understand that's Jesus. You know what a bat mitzvah is? I'm saying it wrong.
Bar mitzvah.
Bar mitzvah. Yeah. They're expecting that child to be the Messiah. That's why they have a big deal for it. And I've always gotten me funny, because when you get a fat kid, a fat Jewish kid who's a glutton, you're going to perform a ceremony that thinking he's the Messiah?
And his mother wasn't a virgin.
And his mother wasn't a virgin? They even had bar mitzvahs for the girls, I've heard. Come on. Have a guy in your church, talk to your pastor first. Finds, and there are a few people out there.
That was the coming of age.
Coming of age also for the Messiah, 13. Like he was at the temple, age 13, when his mother. And it's funny how they picked that date, which they don't follow the New Testament, but the New Testament says Jesus showed up on the scene talking with him at 13. But Find a guy, and there's a few good ones out there. They will come to your church or your house, and they will show you the traditional layout of the Passover meal. How the table set it. And everything they do points to Jesus Christ, and they don't even know it. They're blinded. They're still looking for the Messiah. He's come, and Paul is saying it is blinded. They don't see it. Which veil is done away in Christ. The only way a Jewish person is going to see the Old Testament true, if Christ removes that veil. What did Moses do when he removed that veil? It was light. But they couldn't see that light, could they? He had to wear a veil when speaking to them. So they've been blinded all the way through from Exodus 20. All of them, except for a certain age group, excluding Joshua and Caleb, died in the wilderness. Man, they were griping and complaining against God, Moses, and everybody. And I know a few Jews who've had that veil taken away, and they know what the Old Testament is. And that's a wonderful, you know, that pleases God more than a Gentile getting saved, I would think. When a Jew has that veil removed because he's believed on Christ as his Savior. But even unto this day, when Moses is read the law, the veil is upon their heart. Read Romans 10:9 with that one. A Jew cannot be saved unless he hears the word. He's got to hear the New Testament eventually. He's got to hear the gospel. And you can use the Old Testament. But if he doesn't receive Christ as a Savior, he's still got that veil. He's lost. Nevertheless, when it, the heart, draw that it back to the heart, shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. I guarantee that brings God glory when a Jew, when he really receives Christ as his Savior, and he pulls it away, and he just opens that Old Testament. Listen, none save Jews would point to the Old Testament, and Christ is too, I don't know how, because they don't believe Jesus is Messiah, but they're like, boy, he sure fits. But they won't believe, and they can't get that last puzzle piece. There's a lot of writings by rabbis. Oh, man, Christ the teacher. Wow. But that's all he is. He's teacher. He's not the Messiah. He's not the Savior. He's not the one of God. And then he's like, oh, God, why can't you get it? Because you won't believe. And you don't get the full picture. So see, even Paul's telling the Corinthians, it's not the law. It's Christ. Now the Lord is that Spirit, the Holy Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. You had no liberty under the law. So again, now here we are, 2 Corinthians, another epistle. And we're dealing with law and grace. It's a problem. And when you do any kind of public ministry, you will find somebody, well, I do this. You want to smack yourself in the head. But what did Christ do? And you don't want to be harsh, but you really got to get the point. When you're fighting somebody, I mean, not, you know, fist fighting, you're battling words back and forth that what they can do will get them into heaven. And you just got to find us and say, listen, this is the proper thing to say. All right. Wait a minute. Let's calm down here. Let's inhale, breathe. Let's count to 10. Let me just ask you one question and we'll end this whole conversation, okay? So what you're telling me is what you do to get to heaven. And you can name what they say, whatever they do. So what you're telling me is what you're doing is a lot better and more merit than what Jesus, God's Son, did. Now, that answer is yes, and you're done. That veil is on their eyes. because they think they're better than Jesus Christ. Now, if that veil comes off, because, oh, wait a minute, yeah, Christ can save my sins. What other veil came off when Christ became our salvation? That veil that was in the temple. Remember, it ripped from top to bottom? When that veil is removed, not only can you can understand the Old Testament, not only can, are you saved, but you can walk up to God's throne and say, Father, I'm your son by Jesus Christ. My righteousness is Jesus Christ. There's no more veil. I'm at the mercy seat. There is the incense offer of prayers. I've got the bread all lined up, 66 books. I've got the light of the Holy Spirit, the oil. I have been clean. I passed through the fire at the gate. Here I stand at the mercy seat because the veil is open, Lord God the Father. You're his child. What a wonderful thing to have that veil pulled away. You know what that veil was in the Old Testament? That was the high priest. He went in there twice a year, once a year. He went in there for his own sins. And then he went in for the sins of the people. And if he had anything, ever done anything wrong between going into that holy place, he was gone. And no, they did not tie a rope around their leg. If they tied a rope around his leg, he went right there, because God did not say tie a rope around his leg. Aaron's sons just went in there with a lighter or a matchstick, and God said, you're gone. Now get him out of here. When we step out of law and step into grace, we step into the holies of holies. There is the mercy seat. There are the cherubim. You know what the law does? It closes that. And since the law closes the veil, what do you do? What can you put on that mercy seat that will atone for your sins? Nothing. Christ entered into the holies of holies, deposited his blood for our souls. And that veil is open for us today. Now the Lord is that spirit. Paul's going to tell us later on, watch out for spirits. There's another writer that said, try the spirits. John. 1 John, I believe it is. And where the spirit, capital S, of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all with open face, we're not wearing a veil. Beholding as a glass of the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. It comes crystal clear. We take on the glory of God by Jesus Christ. Veil's pulled away. There's nothing hiding me from God and nothing hiding God from me. Except for when I get back in my sin and I get it under the blood again. And get right and repent. Remember that guy? He was involved in chapter 5 of 1 Corinthians. He was involved in a wicked sin. Chapter 2, 2 Corinthians, he's got right. Take him back. Make sure you treat him. You help him. And he's back in the will of God. He's back before the throne. He's got a perfect fellowship with the Father. They're hugging. They're kissing. They got the robe. He's got a ring on him. He's got the shoes. He's got the fatted calf. Does this sound familiar? And there's a party going on that never ends. The prodigal son. That prodigal son never went to the law to come back to the Father. He said, you know what? I've sinned against my Father. I'm going to go back and apologize and accept the fact that I'll just be one of his servants. He didn't say, oh, if I bring this, he didn't bring his Father nothing. If we were under the law, that prodigal son would have bought a lamb. He would have bought a goat. He would have bought a bullock. He didn't have any of that. He just had empty husks and the corn and the pigs ate it. Matter of fact, according to the law, that son would have been very miserable because hogs are unclean animals for a Jewish person. Do away with the law. Use the law to show people their sin, but bring them by Jesus Christ, by the grace. Remove that veil and enter into the holies of holies. And there is God, your Father. There you are as his son. You walk in there. No, no, No Old Testament person ever walked behind that veil but the high priest, and that was it. And many of the years in 1 Kings and 2 Kings, 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, that veil was, that room was locked up, closed up, boarded up. It ain't today. It ain't today. By the grace of God and Jesus Christ, I can. The Bible says, I am seated in holy place. I'm not going to heaven. I am there already. And if the Lord tarries, one day my soul will reach up with me there. And then at the rapture, and after the judgment seat of Christ, then my body will meet up with them. If I go with the rapture, my soul and my body meets up with me there in heaven. I'm there. I'm seated. I'm just waiting to go. I'm waiting for the redemption. I'm waiting. You know, you go to a store where I came from, bottle redemption, can redemption. You buy a Coca-Cola. You take it home. You put it on your shelf. And that Coca-Cola can say, oh, I want to go back to the store. I can't wait to get back to the store. I wish they'd hurry up and drink me. I don't want to go back to the store. Oh, and you pop open that soda, you drink it, you bring it back to the store, and you get 5 cents, and that can gets to be back with his can family. That's how it is. I don't know if that's a good illustration, but I